Now in chapter 7, we have very strong language. Here it says, "And when the Lord thy God shall deliver them before thee, thou shalt smite them and utterly destroy them. Thou shalt make no covenant with them, nor show mercy unto them." Now you see, God has said, "Thou shalt not kill." That's personal animosity, personal hatred that leads to murder. That's a different word. Here, they are to destroy these people in the land. Now, the enemy says, "Oh, this is terrible." That is the liberal, and I consider him the enemy of God because he seems to hate the God of the Old Testament. In fact, he says he does. One called him a bully. God says to utterly destroy them, and they don't like it. And also he says, verse 3, "Neither shalt thou make marriages with them. Thy daughter thou shalt not give unto his son, his daughter shalt thou not take unto thy son." Remember the destruction of Jericho? God says, "Don't you touch a garment, you let them alone. And don't you take even a wedge of gold." They took nothing, they burned the city. And you say that is terrible. Maybe you don't have all the facts. And the interesting thing, the liberal didn't. These people were eaten up with venereal disease. And had they married with them, it would have destroyed the race. Now, Moses didn't know much about disease germs, but God seemed to know a great deal about them. And these people were polluted and corrupt. And God put them out of the land. And he told his own people, "If you indulge in it, I'll put you out of the land." And God told them to destroy their altars, their false worship. This was the thing that they were to do. But God makes it very clear he's a God of love. Listen to this. Verse 7, "The Lord did not set his love upon you or choose you, because ye were more in number than any people, for ye were the fewest of all people. But because the Lord loved you, and because he would keep the oath which he had sworn unto your fathers, hath the Lord brought you out with a mighty hand, redeem you out of the house of bondmen from the hand of Pharaoh, king of Egypt." You remember God said in Exodus, "I've heard their cry." That met a response in the heart of God. He loved them. Now, verse 9, "Knowing therefore that the Lord thy God, he's God, the faithful God which keepeth covenant and mercy with them that love him and keep his commandment to 1,000 generations." And he keeps repeating this, verse 13, "And he will love thee and bless thee and multiply thee and will bless the fruit of thy womb, the fruit of thy land, the corn," and so on. How wonderful it would have been had they believed God. Now he says, verse 18, "Thou shalt not be afraid of them, but shalt remember what the Lord thy God did unto Pharaoh and unto Egypt." This was to encourage them. God would take them into the land, and God would give the land to them. Verse 22, "And the Lord thy God will put out those nations before thee by little and little, that thou mayest not consume them at once." Why did God do that? Well, because he didn't want the wild beasts to take the land. And then in verse 23, "But the Lord thy God shall deliver them unto thee, and shall destroy them with a mighty destruction until they be destroyed." Whether you like it or not, they were destroyed. They were put out of that land because of their abominations. And don't say God was not patient. Way back yonder, God told Abraham, "I'm going to put your children down in the land of Egypt, and they'll not come out for 430 years. Why? The iniquity of the Amorites is not yet full. God says, "I'm going to give the Amorites 430 years to see whether they'll turn to me, whether they'll turn from their sin." And friends, how much longer do you want God to give them? Why, may I say that a landlord wouldn't give any tenant that long to pay his rent. God was giving them 430 years. I don't think the liberal would ask for any more time than that. God is a God of mercy and love in the Old Testament as well as he is in the New Testament.